Yes, it's the same picture, and yet the colors change drastically depending on the support where it's projected. It's the dread of every photographer. You spend time to edit your image, it's your interpretation, you put all your soul into it, and how to keep the same colorimetry on all screens.
Let's be straight, you can't. There, I've destroyed your dreams and hopes, but at least now you're facing the harsh reality. I'll let you get over it, or you can stay with me for a few more minutes on this video. I will explain why it's impossible, and I give you a tip. It's not really gonna fix the problem, but we're going to talk about a tool that few photographers invest in, but that for you, whether now or in the future, could potentially improve your life. Ah, color, such a complex topic, but I will try to simplify it as much as possible so that everyone can understand. I'm not an expert myself, so please allow me to take some shortcuts. Yes, I know, I shouldn't do that. I'm starting to understand how the internet works. I know you're not going to like it, you, my techno-geek friend.
You make a video about color visualization on screens for beginners, and you don't explain that gamma is determined by sensitometry thanks to the slope of the straight part of the HRG field curve? Hello? Delete. No, not just your video. Your channel. Your existence. You are worthless. Posting this kind of comment to show how smart I am makes me feel all powerful.
Yeah, I'm doing characters now. Yeah, I'm gonna stop. So let's stick to two main principles in the way a screen displays a digital signal.
First, the gamma. How easily a screen can have to go from black to white, its contrast if you want, which is represented by a curve. You've probably seen numbers like 1.8, 2.2, 2.4, which represent different gammas with different tones. 2.2 is a standard with fairly neutral tones, a lot of visibility in the grays.
Then the gamut, the color space, corresponding to the range of colors that a given device is able to reproduce.
Let's say this represents the visible spectrum to the human eye. This is the sRGB color space, which is the standard on monitors, printers, and the internet.
Okay, if you globally understand this, we can move on. Why do I say that it's impossible to have identical colors between what you have edited in Lightroom, for example, and the different media where you're broadcasting your image? It's not just the fact that you could have a different gamma or gamut, but the color spaces are not interpreted the same way by different brands, by the same brand, but with different screen models. By the same screen model, but because all the small variations on the production line. Hey, you wanna make it more complex?
Most of today's images are for the web. Once you edit your RAW, you will compress your image, which will have an impact on the colors. Guess what? When you post your image on Instagram, which has its own compression algorithm, it will once again alter the colors, the contrast of your picture.
I have the same problem with video. I want to kill myself every time I see all my pretty videos look on my screen once they go through the YouTube compression. Ah, but we all know who's the worst. Yeah. Have you ever posted a picture on Facebook? Who does that here? You have to stop that right now, okay? This is a picture. This is exactly the same picture posted on Facebook. I promise I didn't change anything. Ah, Facebook. Ah, I spit in your face. Puh. So it's impossible to keep exactly the same colors. Your only solution is to minimize the phenomenon by making your starting images as faithful and accurate as possible to limit the damage. When we started in photography, we invest first in the camera body, then in the holy trinity of lenses, and I agree with that. But afterward, we often fall into the trap of buying more and more random accessories that we don't really need. For my part, I think it's better to invest in a good monitor. During the 3 years I spent in Australia, I edited all my images on a laptop. And when I came back to France, I bought a BenQ screen, but more for video, the EW3270T. And there already I rediscovered all my pictures. Hey, why does everyone have a reddish skin? Ah, that magenta tint. 2 months ago, the same brand contacted me directly, BenQ. They mostly make monitors for image professionals or gamers too, but it's not my universe. And they sent me a screen specially designed for photography, the SW31C. Such a cute little name. Well, you know the drill. When a brand sends you something for free, they hope you'll make some images with it. You're welcome, guys. We even now. But what's the point of a professional screen like this for you? The only solution to keep consistency in the colorimetry through various supports is to master the whole chain of diffusion. It's possible in a particular case that we'll talk about later, but clearly, all the photos that are made to be shared digitally on the internet, on social media, you don't have control over the medium that people are going to use to view your work. Your only possibility is to deliver the most faithful image possible in order to minimize the alterations that your images will inevitably undergo. If already when working on your picture, as I did with my laptop, the skin tones are in fact tomato red, at the end of the chain when you see them on a mobile, whoa-ho-ho. So you need a calibrated screen.
All screens can be calibrated within their display capacity, whether it's a monitor or a laptop, even a tablet or a mobile.
So that's pretty good news. That means you can improve what you already have.
This is called software calibration, which uses software and also systems to measure colors, but also sometimes the brightness, the color temperature of the room.
Yes, because that also plays a role. As I said, it's a topic. Color Monkey, X-Rite, you may have already heard those kinds of names. There are plenty of others, and I let you do your own research. You won't like resources on the internet.
But screens like the BenQ, of this range at least, add in addition an advanced factory calibration by certified people who will manually set the color spaces on each screen and issue a calibration certificate that you receive with the purchase.
I would add that calibration changes over time. It's not you do it once and basta. No, you have to recalibrate from time to time, and this from the most basic to the high-end screens. So yes, the higher the range, the less the alteration, but in any case, you'll have to come back to it at some point. I was telling you that there is one particular case where you can potentially have control of the colors all the way to the end, and that's printing. This is a subject I will cover in depth here at some point. Subscribe, ring the bell. As a photographer, having your creation in front of you is a very powerful feeling. For me, the culmination of an image is the physical medium. The photograph is a different piece of art when it's printed. And paradoxically, even more today, in an ultra-digital world, but yeah, we'll talk about that again.
You talk about printing and digital, but you don't develop a substantiated statement about the uprising of NFT and crypto art and the implications that non-fungible works will have in the future? You are ugly and your videos smell like shit.
I'll give you an example. The prints behind me were for an exhibition we did a long time ago with two friends, another photographer and a graphic designer. Go check their Instagram, Lolo Leo. The theme was Redheads. We mixed photograph with lettering. Yeah, we are geniuses. Once all the images were finished, I had to edit them all again for printing because the colorimetry was... I work with Jean-Pierre Maillot, a fantastic printer here in Lyon, but if you're interested, he works worldwide, so I put a link in the description. Not only is he a great food photographer, but he's a real expert in color. And we had to rework all the colors on his screens because at the time I didn't have a monitor for photography either.
In digital, we mix the red, green and blue photo seeds to create all the other colors for each pixel. In printing, we will use pigment, inks, and for that a different colorimetric mode that we call the CMYK, based on four ink plates, the cyan, the magenta, the yellow, and then one of black.
You will just have to convert your RGB numerical values into CMYK print values. And this is where the problems happen when you switch from one color space to another. Why?
Do you remember the colors visible by the human eye? Here is the color space sRGB, and here is the CMYK. There are colors that these two modes are not able to represent reciprocally.
Our standard monitors are in sRGB, hence the surprises when you print your work. Monitors like the BenQ or other brands, but which are specific to photography and image work in general, are capable of displaying 99% of another color space, the Adobe RGB, which as you see includes all CMYK colors. You can see the colors you really get when printed. Don't worry, I know I'm talking about things that are not for everyone, especially since it's a budget. But at a certain point, if you embrace a career in photography or in image in general, graphic designer, videographer, etc., it's an investment we all have to make at some point, but many of us make it much later than we should. I won't go into details about the screen in particular, you know me. I don't do tech review here and I don't give specific buying advice. I'm really happy with the quality of the screen though. It's amazing to go back to some old pictures and see that you have to redo everything. So I'm not going to tell you that it's the best on the market because I don't know. I haven't tested other brands, other products, but I still want to give a good point to BenQ on something else. I really flied over the subject in this video. Colorimetry is a profession in its own right. There is so much to say. We could also have talked about the depth of the screen. 8-bit and bit, we didn't even mention ICC profiles. But if you want to learn more about that, they have done a real good pedagogical work on their website. You have a lot of explanation on everything we saw in this video and much more. I will put a link in the description. Okay, this is the third episode of the Just One Tip videos, which was supposed to be a 2-3 minutes format. How far are we now? Yeah, that's it. It's going well. I'm gonna put 2 cool videos for you to watch here, and then see you, mate. Keep on creating.
Want to learn more? Oh yeah, so it's up to me to find out for myself. So what's the point of watching your videos then? Okay, time to cancel you from the YouTube photo game.